by my colleague Glenn Lindsay. We are in the Fort Lauderdale office of Baker Donelson, and this is the last of our four-part series on Florida foreclosures. For those of you who have been here for all of the previous webinars, we appreciate your attendance, and if you have any issues with obtaining your CLE credit, let us know. We'll be happy to help you out with that. I still have a couple of questions pending from Tuesday that I'm working on getting back to people on, so hang tight and I will get back to you on those. And this will wrap up our series, but if you have questions that come up after today's webinar, feel free to reach out to me or to Glenn, and we can do our best to get you some answers. Today we are talking about post-judgment motion practice and foreclosure appeals. Post-judgment motions come up generally after the entry of a final judgment and can be raised by either party for a variety of reasons. Glenn is going to talk about those. And then I'm going to get into some of the basics of foreclosure appeals. Most of the people that are on this webinar will never actually handle an appeal because you're either not an attorney or you're a litigation attorney. But I think that it's really important for anybody who's working in the foreclosure context to understand the implications of your actions in the trial court and what could happen to you later on appeal. For our clients, this is a source of great cost and a great expenditure of time. So I think that it's really good if we cover both of these things. So Glenn, I'm going to go ahead and pass it over to you to start talking about post-judgment motion practice.
Thanks, Heidi. One of the key issues to determine in the event that you're either contemplating filing a post-judgment motion or have one filed against you is to make a determination whether it's a motion for rehearing slash new trial governed by 1.530 or if it's a motion to vacate an order or set aside a judgment under 1.540. There are important time differences and limitations on both that need to be addressed and understood in order to best either frame your motion or respond to the defendant's motion. If you are going under a 1.530 motion for a rehearing or a new trial, it must be filed within 10 days of the operative order that you're seeking to set aside. So you don't have very much time to get that out there if you are seeking it. These relate to issues of law, that the court made a determination that the plaintiff had standing and the defendant disagrees with that legal determination that the plaintiff was the proper party to bring the foreclosure action, that the breach letter complied with the requirements of paragraph 22 of the mortgage, other such things along that line. And most of the time, the motion for rehearing itself is going to be ruled on by the court without need to set a hearing. A lot of the jurisdictions down in Florida have specific rules on this, and it can kind of put you in a quandary if the court is sitting on your motion and not ruling on it when you're precluded by the local rules from setting it for hearing. But nonetheless, don't make the mistake of attempting to set it for hearing unless the court instructs you to do so. Otherwise, they generally don't look favorably upon that. In the event that the court does grant the motion for rehearing, they will then request that you set the new hearing and coordinate it with opposing counsel. This does not mean that they've granted your motion or that they're going to change their opinion, but they have opted to give you another opportunity to speak or, in the event that it's a new trial, to present your case over again. But the operative thing there is that it relates to questions of law and that it has to be filed within 10 days of the order in order to be timely.
Just to add a note onto that, and this crosses over into some of the appellate discussion that we will have, but if you timely file a motion for rehearing, you are going to toll the time required to file your notice of appeal. And in fact, this rule did change, I believe it was late last year, and now you have 15 days to file your motion for rehearing. But say, for example, on that 15th day, you file a motion for rehearing regarding a judgment that's been entered or a final order that's been entered. You typically would have 30 days from the date of that or from the date of rendition of that order to appeal it. But as long as a motion for rehearing is timely filed, you are tolling the time to later appeal. So I guess the only correction that I would make is that we should have said 15 days instead of 10, but you're tolling that time, and so if you make sure you get it in on time, then you're okay. If you are outside that time period, you're not only foreclosing your right to seek rehearing, you are also foreclosing your right to appeal later.
what I get for using the 2013 rules of civil procedure. And then also keep in mind with the tolling issues that you're not getting a start over date for the 30 days to file the appeal. It only tolls while the active period. So if you take 14 days to file your motion for rehearing, you don't get a new 30 after that's been adjudicated. Now, with respect to motions to vacate judgment, these are governed by Rule 1.540. This is the one that we more commonly see, and it has typically what's understood as a one-year statute of limitations, although 1540B has five different categories that you can seek to seek relief from the judgment. There's also 1540A governing clerical mistakes. We're not really going to touch on that because that issue arises in a very, very, very narrow set of circumstances such that it will not likely be part of your practice or part of anything that you encounter. But in the event you do have a 1540A motion, there is no set statute of limitations on the one-year requirement. With respect to B, the three most common categories are mistake, inadvertence, or excusable neglect is category one, newly discovered evidence, which by due diligence could not have been discovered in time to move for a new trial or rehearing is two, and then fraud is the third. The other two categories are that the judgment or decree is void or that the judgment's been satisfied or is otherwise no longer equitable to proceed. B4 and B5 have no statute of limitations, but when a judgment is if you're seeking under B4 that it's void, the only situations that I'm really aware of would be if you're arguing that the court lacked subject matter jurisdiction, which could never be waived. Otherwise, it most likely is going to be something that is voidable.
There's one other example that comes up pretty frequently when someone argues that a judgment is void, and that is that if service of process was improper from the beginning, then the judgment is void regardless of how old it is. So you must always check to make sure you have good service of process.
Correct. I overlooked that as I was dealing with contested cases that have been adjudicated, but Heidi's absolutely right that obviously if the party's never been served, they can come forward at any time and say that, unless they've waived it by filing a pleading in the case prior. And then if you're attempting to go under B5, there's a very, while it's a broadly worded category of when it's equitable, it's very narrowly interpreted, and the court does not like to grant 1540 B5 motions very often. You have to show that it wouldn't otherwise fall within any other category. And again, the times when that would happen would be if the judgment's satisfied or if you have a situation where the underlying judgment got vacated or something through an appeal in a different instance. These do not relate to questions of law or legal determinations, so it's good to keep in mind if a defendant attempts to bring a 1540 motion outside the 15-day rehearing window, if you can find a way to try and categorize or your counsel can find a way to try and categorize that as a legal question and argue that it's time barred, it's one more arrow in your quiver to try and argue those instances. The other thing is with respect to B2, the newly discovered evidence, which by due diligence couldn't have been discovered in time, there's a high bar there, not that the work wasn't done, but that the work couldn't have been done. So if you see situations where for a while a lot of people were trying to come in and vacate based on the popularity with the term and the understanding of robo-signers, and that once you had gotten a deposition where someone had admitted to being a robo-signer, that would vacate all other judgments. And the courts have held that if you didn't attempt to take that deposition in your case, that evidence was always out there, and that you made the strategic decision not to depose that individual. You can't now come and say that it was newly discovered and you couldn't have done it otherwise. So it's important to keep in mind not just that new evidence has come to light, but new evidence that could not have otherwise been discovered. If they're arguing a 1540B3 fraud motion, their opposing counsel is typically going to argue that they're entitled to an evidentiary hearing on that matter. Some of the things that they like to claim are fraudulent would be any sort of issues with assignments of mortgage for endorsement stamps on notes that they claim were improperly added after the filing of the foreclosure complaint. Opposing counsel is going to try and say that they're entitled to an evidentiary hearing on those issues. And by and large, 1540B3 motions, the appellate courts generally do prefer that they have an evidentiary hearing, but it's important to figure out if you're facing one of these, whether or not there are any alternative means that you can use to argue to the court that the evidentiary hearing would be unnecessary. In the instance where they're claiming that you have a fraudulent assignment of mortgage or potentially fraudulent assignment of mortgage, if you also had proof of standing by other means to show that the plaintiff owned the loan on the date of filing the complaint, if the complaint had a blank endorsed note attached to it, and that was the same note that was tendered at the entry of the judgment, you can attempt to argue that the evidentiary hearing would be unnecessary because the assignment of mortgage is superfluous. So even if the court does make the determination that it's fraudulent, it wouldn't matter because the judgment would still be upheld on that prong based on the blank endorsed note which was provided. So even though a lot of opposing counsel are going to knee-jerk and say that they're entitled to the evidentiary hearing and they'll have plenty of case law in support of their position, if you can find a way to sidestep that or point out that their issue is not in fact a nexus issue that shapes whether or not the judgment will stand or fall, you can use that as a way to avoid the need for the evidentiary hearing. If the judgment's not void and they're attempting to bring it under B4, you need to have a good understanding of why it's merely voidable and argue that the one-year statute of limitations still comes into effect. The courts obviously want finality of judgments here, and so they're not looking to reopen 3- and 4-year-old cases. So outside of the narrow jurisdictional limits that Heidi and I talked about earlier, odds are the judgment's merely voidable and not void. And so you would want to be sure that you harp on that in your responsive pleading or at the hearing on that to force them back into the one-year statute of limitations issue. So outside of fraud, the courts are somewhat reluctant to grant evidentiary hearings on these matters. In the event that they're claiming it was mistake or inadvertence due to a calendaring error, the court might grant an evidentiary hearing to take evidence on the scheduling process that is used. But really, outside of that, you're probably not going to be hit with an evidentiary hearing on a 1540B4 or B motion.
The easiest way that I have employed to try to defeat a post-judgment motion to vacate a judgment under 1.540 is by arguing to the court that the motion itself does not demonstrate a colorable entitlement to relief. That's the standard that the courts of appeal will review in order to determine whether the trial court's actions in granting an evidentiary hearing were appropriate. Many judges that are specifically assigned to the foreclosure divisions in Florida are looking to find an expeditious way to move the cases along. And so the more evidentiary hearings they need to schedule, the more it's going to tie up their dockets. If you can successfully argue to them during the initial hearing on a review of just the preliminary merits of the motion that there is no colorable entitlement to relief reflected in the motion itself, then you're simply attacking the way that the motion is drafted, and it gives the judge sometimes an easy out if the motion itself hasn't been appropriately arguing the legal standard that's necessary under 1.540.
The next scenario are motions to cancel sale. See these quite frequently, typically in the form of an emergency basis on the day of or a day or two before the sale is set to take place. The vast majority of what we see, at least in South Florida, are equity arguments to allow the parties additional time to attempt to resolve the matter post-judgment. Their client has a short sale contract, their client's applying for a modification and is going through the process, client wants to keep the property, they need additional time to find a new dwelling. Those are typically the arguments that we hear down here on those issues. Generally, we find that even when the motion to cancel sale itself may not be meritorious in our eyes, the courts are generally amenable to one or two possible brief continuances to allow a short sale to finalize, or in the event that modification paperwork has been submitted and confirmed received by the plaintiff, then they'll give it a little bit of additional time to allow for that process. But they're really starting to clamp down. You have a lot of judges ordering no further continuances, and really outside of CFPB or truly extenuating circumstances, the courts are relatively loath to grant more than one or two continuances, regardless of who is requesting them. That also cuts in our favor. I know sometimes we need to request to cancel a sale for various reasons, and the courts are really clamping down on that. You can also have motions to cancel sales that are substantive, where a motion to vacate has just been filed, or is concurrently filed, or there's an appeal pending and they want to seek to vacate the sale while awaiting a ruling on the court on that. With the issue of appeals, by and large, those weren't being contested down here very much earlier on, but starting around 2012 or 2013, lenders really started pushing back on those appeals and saying, you know, no, you don't just get to remain in the property while you're appealing a trial judgment without posting a bond. The courts have been pretty accepting of the requirement to post a supersedious bond. Where we've seen a large division has been determining the value of that bond, or what constitutes that bond. Some of the things that we've seen have been fair market value, monthly rental payments paid into the court registry during the pendency of the appeal. Some have used some variation of the judgment plus interest, or some fraction of the judgment plus interest. And generally, once we're able to get the court to require the posting of a bond in order to cancel a sale, very, very rarely do you see a defendant or defense counsel actually able to tender that money and stay that sale. So it's important to remember to talk with your counsel, or if you are counsel, to talk with your client about whether or not they want to oppose a stay during the appellate period. And if so, figuring out what type of bond you would want to request and how you're going to go about making that request to the court. The other thing that comes up are after sales, the objection to sale. And there's a large shift once the sale has occurred. A motion to cancel sale can be based on pretty much anything, which was what I was trying to get at in that initial portion. We want to do a short sale, we need some more time, just an emotive appeal to the judge to cancel the sale. Once the sale's already occurred, it's pretty set in stone, and you're governed by some pretty strict requirements. It must be filed within 10 days of the issuance of the certificate of sale. Theoretically, according to Florida statutes, after 10 days, the clerk is then to file the certificate of title in favor of the purchasing party. Logistically, we're seeing a relatively large lag time in that. The clerks are overwhelmed, and so they may not get to it until 30, 45, 60 days out, which can be frustrating, but the statutory ruling is still theoretically that you have to file within 10 days. Sometimes what happens, though, is they can file late, and if the clerk sees an objection being docketed, they won't issue the CT absent an order. But you all and your counsel should be aware of that to immediately raise that argument if an objection comes in more than 10 days after the certificate of sale. The objection needs to be based on either an inadequate notice or a grossly inadequate bid price. There has been an amendment based on a Supreme Court case from 2013 that's cited here, the Arcelli versus Chase Home Finance case. That dealt with the situation where both parties were attempting to cancel a sale to work on a modification or otherwise alternative way of satisfying the judgment. The court denied it. It went to sale. It went third party. The court held that the sale was invalid, that the court should have granted the motion to cancel the sale, and that the third party purchaser was basically just out of luck because the plaintiff and the defendant both sought to cancel the sale. There were equitable considerations that would come into play. So it didn't matter that the bid price wasn't inadequate. So that marked kind of a sea change in how the courts are evaluating objections to sale. One of the things to keep in mind is when you get a ruling on an objection to sale, in the event that it's overruled and they allow the sale to stand, you want to make sure that your counsel is including that the clerk is directed to issue the certificate of title forthwith, because without that one key word, the clerk may end up sitting on the CT for another period of time, whereas if they see that the order directs that, they'll immediately or as soon as they get to it have the certificate of title issued. But without that magic word, you may not have that, and they may put it on the back burner. Grossly inadequate bid price has not been predetermined. You used to, but you don't see it as much anymore. The defense counsel would object that if the plaintiff was the winning purchaser, they may have only paid $100 for the property. Hopefully we're all aware by now that we're credited when the plaintiff is a successful bidder, they're credited with bidding the full judgment value. We don't have to purchase the property twice and artificially bid it up if no one else is going to compete with us. So anytime you have the plaintiff as the purchaser, it's almost impossible. In fact, I don't think it's possible to have a grossly inadequate bid price. You may get an improper notice. This happens less often now with online sales, but if the sale had been set to occur on Thanksgiving, then the court may hold that there was a chill on the public bid, and so the sale was improper for being noticed on that day or being noticed on a Saturday, or potentially if the notice of sale wasn't properly published in accordance with the statutory rules. But really outside of that, once you've gone through the sale, unless there's a technical defect with how the sale went forward, the defendant can't come in and make an argument that they would have made in a motion to cancel sale. And it's important to keep that in mind, that once the sale occurs, there's been a large burden shift that they'll have to overcome to invalidate that sale.
All right, so it's time to talk about foreclosure appeals, which is my favorite subject. And the reason that I think it's important everybody understand the basics about foreclosure appeals is because when you bring a file through to judgment, there are important considerations to talk to your client about before you proceed with something on the basis that simply you have a favorable judge. Let me give you an example. There are some judges in some jurisdictions that are extremely favorable to our lending clients and have a tendency to rush through trials because they already know the witnesses or they know what they can expect will be our evidence. The problem with that is that if a court reporter is present at the trial and opposing counsel is looking to appeal, the Court of Appeal cannot look at the judge's independent and outside knowledge, and the court can't consider things that the witnesses have testified to in other trials. The court can only look at what we have done in this particular trial. And so we get burned sometimes because a matter might proceed with a court reporter at trial or at a hearing, and that record in and of itself does not demonstrate a basis to affirm. So in essence, the Court of Appeal will reverse just because they don't know why it is that the trial court has ruled the way it has, but our transcript doesn't reflect what it needs to. So one of the things that I talked about a few minutes ago was the idea of tolling your time for an appeal. This is something that on the plaintiff side we don't employ quite as much as defendants would, but it's important to understand it because sometimes there are occasions where plaintiffs need to appeal as well. If a final order is entered and you file a motion for a rehearing and it's timely, the final order does not become what's called rendered until that motion for rehearing is resolved. So for example, if 45 days after filing the motion for rehearing, the trial court denies it, that the date that denial appears on the docket will be the date it was rendered. And that is when your appellate clock starts to tick. So keep very close track of those deadlines. And one of the things that I will recommend to you at the end of this segment is that you should constantly be in communication, either within your firm or outside of your firm, with an appellate lawyer so that you can get guidance on these things. The most common appeals in a foreclosure context are first a final appeal, second, a non-final appeal, and third, an extraordinary writ. I'm going to cover some basic examples of each of these, not going into too much detail on each one, but there are a couple of primary examples where you are most likely to see these things occur. Appeals of final orders are generally the appeal of a final judgment in a foreclosure. So after the final judgment is rendered, whether or not there's a motion for rehearing, Once that rendition occurs, you have 30 days to file a notice of appeal, and that's when borrowers generally will appeal. If there is an appeal of a summary judgment, then the Court of Appeal is going to review your case de novo. It means they're going to look at it fresh. They're going to review the record and make their own determination without deferring to the trial judge. However, if a final judgment is entered after a trial, then the Court of Appeal is going to give the trial judge a lot more deference. And there are a couple of additional factors that go into it. But keep that general concept in mind when you're in the trial court. And last week when we talked about summary judgments, one of the things that I suggested is you should evaluate whether it's worthwhile to push for summary judgment, knowing you will have a more difficult burden on appeal. And in the alternative, whether it is more worthwhile to expend the time and cost up front of going to trial and getting a judgment which may be a little more airtight than a summary judgment. The appeal is considered final in this case because the judicial labor in a case has ended. So that's the question to always ask yourself from an attorney perspective. If you're wondering, is this order that I'm reflecting on a final order? Has it ended the judicial labor in the case? A post-judgment order is not going to have the same effect as a final judgment. So we will cover that in a minute, but final judgments are always going to be a final appeal. It gets initiated by filing the notice of appeal. The notice of appeal is simply a 1 to 2 page document identifying for the court what the order is that you are intending to appeal. You would file it with a filing fee. And then when there's a final appeal, the clerk of court is who prepares the record on appeal. The record is going to include a number of things that I will go through, but there's a distinction between the appeal of a final order versus the appeal of a non-final order, and that is who is preparing the record. So on a final appeal, you get the most time to prepare your briefs, and the clerk has the burden of preparing the record. So it takes a little bit of the burden off of the parties. If we appeal a non-final order, in a foreclosure context, that is generally the appeal of a motion to vacate a final judgment or a post-judgment motion of some kind. It's considered a non-final order because, in essence, the judicial labor in the case has already ended. It ended with the final judgment, but this is something that came after the final judgment. So it changes things a little bit. It's going to be initiated again by filing a notice of appeal, but now the clerk of court's not preparing your record. If you are the party who is filing the appeal, you now have the burden of submitting an appendix along with your initial brief. Your time for filing changes a little bit as well. If you were appealing a final order, you would have 70 days to file your initial brief. On a non-final order, you're getting 15 days to file your initial brief. Along with the initial brief, you have to put together an appendix, which is in essence the same as the record that the clerk would prepare. It's your responsibility to compile all the documents, the transcripts, whatever it was that was utilized to make the decision in the lower court. You have to organize them and present them to the appellate court for their consideration. If I really wanted to help you learn about extraordinary writs, I would call on Judge Melanie May from the 4th CCA. But Judge May's knowledge probably extends farther than what most of us need to know for purposes of foreclosure appeals. So instead, I've decided to focus on three of the extraordinary writs just to give you some examples. One of the mistakes that I see attorneys making who are using the foreclosure context as a method for dabbling in appeals a little bit here and there is that people will frequently file a notice of appeal, treating it as though it's final, when in fact they really intended to file a non-final appeal or to file an extraordinary writ. The practical difference between writs and actual appeals is really sort of just in the wording and in the way that these things are addressed by the court. There are some different legal standards that are applied, but keep in mind, for example, when you file a notice of appeal on either a final or non-final order, what you are going to be asked to do is at some later date submit a brief. When it comes to writs, however, you're not submitting a brief at a later date, you are submitting a petition. So it is a petition asking the court to issue a writ. And these three are the ones that I see most commonly in this context. First is the petition for a writ of prohibition. If you file one of those, then you're asking the court, the appellate court, to stop the trial court from exercising its jurisdiction. I was in the middle of trial one time and identified some information that led me to believe that the trial judge should likely be disqualified. And so I made an appropriate motion in the trial court, knowing that the trial judge would deny it, but I had to get it denied in order to seek relief from the appellate court. Once that order was denied by the trial court, I could go to the appellate court with a petition for writ of prohibition. And that was my request to the appellate court to ask them to tell the trial court judge that he could no longer preside over my trial. The second example is a writ of mandamus. If you petition the court for a writ of mandamus, you're asking the court to simply nudge the trial judge to perform something, some act that is part of their duties that's not a discretionary act, meaning they don't have a choice whether or not to take action. They simply need to take action. And the most common example is compelling the trial judge to rule on a motion that may have been pending for quite a while, and the parties simply can't get the judge to rule. Finally, a petition for writ of certiorari is filed in order to get an order reviewed that you otherwise couldn't directly appeal. So take discovery orders, for example. If I'm being asked to disclose some information in discovery that would cause irreparable harm if I were to disclose it, then by the time we get to the point where I could file a plenary appeal or final appeal, it would be too late. The information would already be disclosed. So if the trial judge is trying to force me to disclose something, and I genuinely believe that I am not legally obligated or that I have a legal defense to that disclosure, then seeking a writ of certiorari from the Court of Appeal is what's going to protect me. Certiorari is always what we use in the discovery context. So those will come in handy for you as well. Now, it's important to talk about the record, and this is the area that I think is by far the most critical for trial attorneys. Frequently, when cases come to me on appeal, they have already gone through the trial court, and they have already passed through a number of different hands. So I have no control over what's happened. I have to sometimes tell my clients we are going to lose on appeal because of what has happened in the trial court. And so the number one thing that trial attorneys can do to help your appellate attorneys and ultimately to help your clients by saving them time and money is to make sure that you have a good record for any potential appeal that could come later. Some of the things that are included with the record are things you would see on the docket in the trial court, transcripts that you can use. You can either file your transcripts from trial or from a hearing or whatever it may be, file them with the clerk of court in the lower court, and they might automatically get into the appellate record. But if they don't, the appellate rules also provide for the opportunity to supplement the record. There is one rule in the appellate rules that provides that if you didn't have a court reporter to help preserve your record, you can do something that's called a statement of evidence. However, it's very, very difficult to accomplish this. The way that a statement works is after your hearing, you would essentially type up a list of items that you believe were discussed. I've seen some attorneys type it up as though they're typing an actual transcript, but I don't recommend doing it in that form. And then you present it to the other side to see if they agree this is what happened at the hearing. If the other side agrees, then you can submit it agreed. If the other side does not agree, then you have to go back before the judge who heard the proceedings. Here's where it gets tricky. If you had a trial 3 months ago before a judge in, say, Palm Beach County, and there was no court reporter present, and now you want to appeal something that happened at the trial, you can sit down and type a statement of the evidence, and because you might be infuriated by what happened in the trial court, maybe you have a great recollection of those facts. However, if the other side does not agree with you that the facts you have typed are actually what happened, you have to rely only on the trial judge's independent recollection of the events that transpired. Most of the time, what we see happening is if a borrower, for example, tries to type up a transcript of something they think was reversible error at trial, and then they try to present it to the trial judge, the judges are saying, I try so many of these cases, I cannot possibly remember what happened at your trial on that day. So statement of evidence in this context with this kind of a volume practice is extremely risky. And if you see any opportunity that you may need to appeal something, invest the money and cover the cost of the court reporter up front. It will save you a world of headache at the end. The most important thing to remember in preparation of the record is that if a trial judge did not have the opportunity to correct its own error, the appellate court will not correct the error for them. So that means that if you want to appeal something that you have raised in the trial court, you must raise a proper objection. And not only must you raise a proper objection, it has to be contemporaneous with the issue that you've identified. And then finally, you also have to get the trial court to rule on your objection. So frequently, and we talked about this a little bit on Tuesday during our webinar, if you're in trial and you see that the judge understands what you meant to object to because they are nodding or giving you some sort of other nonverbal indicators, it is acceptable and the courts of appeal will sympathize with you if you have to gently prod the trial judge to give you an actual verbal ruling. But that's really important for preserving your record for appeal. Appeals can easily be won and lost based on how closely you pay attention during trial. And that's really why a lot of trial attorneys in a multitude of practices like to bring appellate lawyers with, because they sit at counsel table and they are, quote unquote, the thinking lawyer who is there simply to help preserve the record, to identify potential problems, and to help with evidentiary issues on objections. Here are a few tips for trial lawyers to follow. And they really all boil down to one conclusion, and that is to consult with an appellate lawyer. First, I would recommend that everyone consult with an appellate lawyer if you are determining whether you should fight for a bond if the case is to be stayed. Glenn touched on this briefly, and it's something that's provided for in the appellate rules in Florida. Specifically, if you want to take a look at the rule, it's Rule 9.310 of the appellate rules, and the rule tells us that the case may be stayed, and in this case it would usually be a sale, a foreclosure sale, may be stayed pending an appeal. And that stay is discretionary, according to the trial court judge. So there's no hard and fast rule in a foreclosure judgment that it must be stayed or that it cannot be stayed or that there are certain conditions. It's completely discretionary. The trial judges know this, so I would not recommend that you try to convince them otherwise, but generally what I will do in order to protect my client's interests is first evaluate my likelihood of success on appeal. If my likelihood of success on appeal is extremely high, and I am abundantly confident that I will win this one for my client and that we have a sufficient record and the law is in our camp, then I will fight for bond. I will acknowledge to the trial court that it is discretionary. However, the purpose of asking for a bond is to protect the enforceability of a judgment. And so in my case, if I'm representing a lender in a foreclosure context, my goal is to protect my client's ability to later enforce that judgment. If there is no formula that is set and there's no bond that's required, then there's no way for me to protect against things like wear and tear of the property, the non-payment of taxes or insurance. Some borrowers are renting out the properties and are collecting rent. So if the borrower happens to know that they don't have a good shot on appeal, then they might not have much incentive to protect that property while the appeal is pending. Generally, if I explain it that way to the trial judge, they're much more sympathetic. And the bond can be something as simple as the rent. Instead of being paid to the borrower, the rent is paid into the court registry. Or the borrower is required to pay for their own taxes and insurance and during the pendency of the appeal, and they have to provide verification that they have done so. And as soon as they fail to provide that verification, then the sale can be automatically reset. Keep in mind that after rendition of a final judgment, the trial court has lost jurisdiction of the case, except for the limited relief that's provided by 1.540 and to enforce that judgment. Well, now that we're on appeal, 1.540 no longer applies, but the trial court will still maintain their jurisdiction to be able to enforce. So that's why even with an appeal pending, you can still go forward with a sale and you can still discuss the bond issue. On the flip side of that, if I evaluate an appeal and it looks like there may be some issues on appeal and there is a potential loss to my client, the last thing I want to do is force a sale through to any third party and then risk that my client is going to have to incur additional costs by reversing that sale. So in that case, if the court's inclined to grant me the requirement of a bond, I might also recommend to my client that they should consider a total debt bid or essentially guarantee that the property is sold back to my client where they can hold it in REO, and I would recommend that they not market list or sell the property while the appeal is pending. The second thing that I would very strongly recommend that you talk to an appellate lawyer about is whether you should confess error. No one ever wants to confess error. It's an admission of guilt in a criminal case. That sort of feeling is what we feel as appellate lawyers if we have to confess error in an appeal. But it's very important that we remove ourselves emotionally from our case, because if I push forward on an appeal that is going to be a losing appeal that I could have identified in the beginning, I have now incurred additional attorney's fees for my client, and I have invited negative case law. The courts of appeal in Florida have become much more willing to issue case law on some of these issues and to provide us with guidance. That's very helpful. But if we know that they're going to issue an opinion on something that we already have concluded was incorrect, there's no need to invite it. If we confess error, they are sometimes less likely to write opinions that would be extremely damaging. And so it's important that instead of being proud of yourself for fighting through a trial and winning just for the sake of winning, you should really invite somebody to look at the merits of your case and determine whether this might be one of those cases where it's more worthwhile to save the time and the money and confess error, let the trial judge or the appellate court know that the trial judge made an error for whatever reason and that the case should be sent back for further adjudication. Finally, the last tip that I would offer to you and what you really should discuss with an appellate lawyer as well as with your client is when it would be appropriate for you to appeal an incorrect ruling. We all have sometimes been in court and faced a judge who, for whatever reason, gave us a ruling we were not pleased with. And sometimes we can take that analysis so far as to conclude that the ruling was simply wrong according to the law. And maybe we know that on appeal we would certainly win, but there are additional considerations for that. For example, appeals in various courts around in the DCAs around Florida can take different amounts of time. I have some appeals in the 4th District that have taken a year to 18 months. Appeals in the 3rd District tend to go a little bit faster. But my point is that regardless, that's an investment of time for your client. It's also an investment of a lot of appellate fees. You need a specialized skill set to be able to handle appeals effectively in Florida. And so sometimes that comes with larger fees, and that doesn't always fit most appropriately into our client's business model. The other side of that consideration is that if you are asking your client to appeal one ruling based on one reason, you should also consider whether the appellate court could give you an unfavorable ruling on a different reason. There's a doctrine in Florida appellate courts that's called the Tipsy Coachman Doctrine. And it says that if the trial court reached the right conclusion, but for the wrong reason, then it can still be affirmed on appeal. So if I want to nitpick one small error that I believe that the trial judge made, I might win that one small error on appeal. However, the appellate court might identify something that was even more problematic, and ultimately I would lose and potentially create very negative case law for my client. So that's something that I am always going to avoid doing. That concludes our summary of appellate issues in Florida, as well as the post-judgment motion practice. Our contact information is on your screen, and as I said at the beginning, we're happy to answer any questions that you have. We really thank you for spending your time with us. We hope that this four-part webinar series has been beneficial and educational for you, and at least for the attorneys and the certified paralegals on the line, that you will benefit from some free CLE credits. So thanks again, everybody. Have a great Thursday, and we will talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you all.